My name is Rick Renner, and today I am seated on ruins under the great stadium of Sardis. Sardis was the capital of the Lydian kingdom, and then it was a very important Roman city in the Roman province of Asia. And 2,000 years ago, this was the passageway that ran under the bleachers of the great stadium. It's long. In fact, it's nearly 1,000 feet long. And hundreds, even thousands of people walked back and forth through these passageways, which were much deeper at that time, looking for the entrance into the stadium where they would find their seat and they could sit to watch the games. People loved the games, both in the Greek and in the Roman world. The Greeks loved foot races. Romans loved everything. Gladiator fights, animal fights, chariot races, foot races. They came here to be entertained by sports. And they really loved foot races, which occurred here. And I think about this when I read Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. Listen to this. It says, "Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us." I just love that it says the race is set before us. It means you and I don't have to figure out the race. If we'll just obey God and get in the race and move our feet, the Holy Spirit will direct us correctly. The race has been predetermined. The race has been set before you. God is just waiting for you to put on your running shoes and jump into the race of faith. But for you to run your race all the way to the end, this verse says you have to remove every weight. Weights will hold you down. Weights will stop you from reaching the end of your race. Many people start well, but they don't finish well because they didn't shed all those extra weights and all those hindrances in their life. Those things will hold you down. Those things will prevent you from reaching your goal. You've got to lay aside every weight. It's good to start well, but God also wants you to finish well. And that is what I'm going to talk to you about today.
Stay tuned for a teaching you can trust, a message that will inspire, strengthen, and equip you with vital insight and understanding from the Word of God. Here's Rick.
Thank you for joining me for today's program. Today, we're going to continue talking about finishing your assignment. What has God asked you to do? If you know what He's asked you to do, have you done it? Have you finished exactly what He told you to do? You know, it's very doubtful that God's going to give you another assignment until you finish the one He's already asked you to do. You may be wishing that your assignment would change, but if God's already explicitly designed a plan for you and made it known to you, He's not going to give you another assignment until you complete the one that's already been given to you. So you need to jump in the race, keep running, 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 till finally you get to the end and you finish what God has asked you to do. I told you in the previous program that the man who trained me for ministry said, "Rick, I've observed in life that a lot of people start well, but they don't finish well." He said it like this: "People begin with a bang and they end with a fizzle." Oh, don't let that be you. You know, when I was a younger man, I loved to start projects, but I didn't like to do what had to be done to finish a project. I had to learn through life. It's not enough to start. You have to finish. What has God asked you to do that you started well, that you have not finished well? You need to really look at that and go to the Lord, ask Him to forgive you for not finishing and to give you strength to finish that race until you complete your assignment. And if you need somebody to pray with you that you'll have strength to finish the race, call us. We would love to put our faith together with you for whatever the dream is that God has put into your heart. And by the way, if you're not a partner, please become a partner with our ministry. We would love for you to join us to help us take the teaching of the Bible to people that are really hungry for the Bible. And by the way, we're believing for a revival of the Bible. That's what we're believing for. But right now I'm offering you my series, which is called "It's Time to Finish Your Assignment." I love this series. It's so full of encouragement about finishing what God has asked you to do. We're also offering you my book called "Dream Thieves, Overcoming Obstacles to Fulfill Your Dreams." And guess what? Today it is free. Today only. Today only. It is my gift to you. If you'll call us or send us an email right now today, we'll put it in the mail. We'll get it right to you. The back of the book says, when a dream first enters your heart, there's a sense of excitement and expectation. Then life happens. What do you do when life happens? Dream thieves come to steal the dream of God out of our heart. But you can overcome obstacles to fulfill your dreams. And today only, this is my gift to you, just as a way of saying thank you for being a part of our program. Thanks. Call us. Tell us today. We'll get it right in the mail to you. But today, we're going to talk about finishing your assignment. And today, we're going to return to 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 24. And in the beginning of today's program, I was under the arch of the stadium in the ancient city of Sardis. That stadium is amazing. And I want to tell you, it is very hard to get to that stadium. It is really a physical feat to get there, and that is why it is not open to the public. But there were stadiums like that all over the Roman province of Asia. As I told you in the last program, there was a monumental stadium in Ephesus. Believers were killed there, but primarily there were foot races in that stadium. There was a big stadium in Laodicea. In fact, Laodicea had the biggest stadium in the whole Roman province of Asia. There was a big stadium in Aphrodisias. It's the most well-preserved stadium of the whole Roman province of Asia. It is just amazing. In Sardis, where I was standing at the beginning of today's program, there is a stadium. And in Corinth, there was a stadium that was the most notable of all of them because it was most famous for foot races. Now, where there were the Olympics, which were held in Olympia, but near the city of Corinth was a little town called Ismia, and Ismia is where the Panhellenic Games were held once every 2 years. It means all the Greeks came there for athletic competitions, and they were most known for foot races. So now Paul's going to write to the Corinthians, and he's going to talk to them about foot races, running in a race. He's using imagery which was really real to the Corinthians. They understood that because they were the host city for all the events that took place next door in Ismia. They all understood foot races and stadiums. So now Paul's going to write to them about them fulfilling God's call on their life. And of course, he's also speaking to me and he's speaking to you. And he's really telling us if we're going to do what God's called us to do, we have to run. It is a competition. There will be challenges along the way and we won't achieve the goal unless we're really committed to achieving it. And I want to tell you that that's true about you. If you're going to get your education, if you're going to lose your weight, if you're going to see your family change, if you're going to do anything that God has asked you to do, it's going to require discipline. It's going to require commitment. You've got to get in the race and finish it. Don't just begin with a bang and end with a fizzle, but go all the way to the end until you achieve what God has explicitly told you to do. And my friend, you have a purpose. God has a plan just for you. Ecclesiastes 3 says, to everything that is under the heaven, there is a purpose. So let me ask you, are you under the heaven? If you're under the heaven, then Ecclesiastes 3 says you have a purpose. You were not born into the world to sit on the couch and to watch television or just take up space. God brought you into this planet to do something, and God has a marvelous plan for your life. He wants to reveal it to you, and He wants you to get in the race and run it all the way to the end. And that's why I want you to get my book called Dream Thieves. This book will help you identify the race that you're supposed to be running. But today we're going to return to 1 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 24. I have my Bible. I hope that you have yours. And in this verse, the Apostle Paul says, know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but only one receives the prize, so run that you may obtain. We covered this yesterday, but today I want to return to this verse. I'm going to refer to my notes because I have a lot of notes to use today. When the Apostle Paul says, run that you may obtain, we saw yesterday, and I want to remind you now, it is the Greek word kata lambano. Oh, this is so powerful in the Greek language. The word kata carries the idea of something that is dominating. The word lambano, the second part of the word, means to take or to receive. But when you compound the two words together, it's to take something and to dominate it. Or you could translate it like this, to seize something, to grab hold of something, to pull something down, to tackle it, to conquer it, to master it, to hold under one's power Or this is the picture of one who sees what he wants. He's running his race. He sees the finish line. It's what he wants. This is the picture of one who sees what he wants, and instead of letting that goal slip away from him, he pounces on it. He seizes it. He latches hold of it with all of his might. Or Paul now uses this word to depict a runner who says to himself, I have resolved, I'm not stopping till I reach the end, and I'm going to reach the end before anybody else. He's running with all of his might. His heart is pumping. His blood vessels are bulging. His chest is pressed forward as he's reaching out. He is committed. He's going to run this race all the way to the end. He's going to pounce on his goal, seize it, and make it his own. Now Paul uses that very word to tell us, if we're going to do what God has asked us to do, we have to have determination and resolve. You can't have a haphazard attitude and finish your race. You cannot be half-hearted, mealy-mouthed, touchy, or easily discouraged. You've got to possess resolve to finish your race. Now, I have to tell you, God has asked me to do some things in my life. None of them have been easy. I wish I could tell you it's just been a piece of cake, but it has not been that case. It's required faith. It's required dedication. It's required discipline. It's required hard decisions. But when you understand what God has asked you to do, there's nothing more important in your life. That's the purpose for which you were born. If you miss that, you have missed the whole purpose. You need to resolve. You're going to finish your race. Do anything you have to do to finish it. Make any decision you have to make. Eliminate anything that has to be eliminated. You're going to get in the race. You're going to run, and keep running as long as you have to run until finally you have obtained. That's how long God wants you to run. He wants you to run until you obtain, until you master what God has asked you to master. In fact, this verse says you are to run. 1 Corinthians 9, verse 24 says you are to run. That word run is the Greek word trecho. The word trecho means to run, but it pictures runners who ran a race in a stadium, like the stadiums that I talked to you about at the beginning of today's programs. They ran before adoring fans who watched them as they were running. This word means to run swiftly, to run speedily, to run without distraction, in order to reach the finish line successfully, to run an uninterrupted, undistracted race to obtain a goal. Wow. For you to finish your race, you've got to give it every ounce of your strength, and you've got to give it complete attention. You can't be on and off and on and off. You've got to be consistent. You've got to give it all your strength. For you to really finish and finish well, you've got to give it your complete attention. It's going to take a 100% commitment. You can't try today, stop tomorrow, then try again, then stop again, be on, be off. You've got to say, I'm on, and I'm not going to be off until I finish. I'm not going to stop until I finish. And I want to use the example of losing weight and physical exercise. Several years ago, I made a decision to lose weight. Maybe you've noticed that I lost a lot of weight. Well, when you lose weight, you have to be committed. If you just look at yourself every day, you're going to say, I can't see any results. That's because results come slowly. They come pound by pound, sometimes ounce by ounce. And if you judge your progress by what you see, you're probably going to be discouraged. So you have to make the decision, regardless of what the scale tells me, regardless of what I see in the mirror, I'm not going to stop. I'm changing the way that I eat. I'm going to lose this weight. And you may not see results immediately, but if you're consistent, if you give it all of your strength, 100% of your concentration, if you're really committed to it day by day, doing what is right, putting one foot in front of the next every day, saying no to the things you need to say no to, and yes to the things you need to say yes to, and stay on track day by day, by day, by day, by day, eventually you will begin to lose weight and you will reach your goal. But you can't be on and off. You've got to be on to reach your goal. Or how about physically exercising? At the same time that I decided to lose weight, I decided I was going to start physically exercising. Well, the flesh hates exercise. In fact, to me, exercise has always been like a dirty word. That's just something I haven't wanted to do. If I had to depend on my comfort and on my flesh to exercise, I would not do it. I had to make a decision. I want my core to be strong. I want my spine to be strong. I want to run my life race as long as I can run it, and therefore I've got to do something starting today. And I made the decision every day I'm going to exercise. And all of these years, I've been exercising every single day. Just today when I got up, I walked into the kitchen, turned on the coffee pot. My flesh said, you don't want to do this exercise today. Don't do this. You do it every day. You can ignore it today. And I said to my flesh, no, you are not going to tell me what to do. I am going to take care of me. And I begin to do my push-ups. And every day in the morning, while I'm waiting for my coffee, I do 70 to 100 push-ups. And little by little, day by day, it began to strengthen my core. And I'm in good shape today. But both of these goals, losing weight and exercising, if you depend on your flesh, you're not going to do it. And you can't be on and off. You've got to be on all the way to the end. The same would apply to making a decision to change the way you handle your finances. You can't be disciplined today and undisciplined tomorrow. If you're going to reach your goal, you have to be consistent. It's going to take every ounce of your strength, and it's going to take your complete attention. You've got to not just begin the race, you've got to keep moving forward, keep moving forward, keep moving forward toward your goal until finally you reach your goal. It's going to take a real commitment for you to begin and a real commitment for you to stay in the race. Again, many people start well, but they don't finish well. Don't let that be your story. Start well and finish well. And if you've kind of messed up along the way, repent and jump back in the race. God is for you, and the Holy Spirit will help you. I want to read an RIV of 1 Corinthians 9, verse 24. Listen to what it says. Don't you know that those who compete in a foot race run with all their might and strength against the runners, but only one wins the competition and takes the prize? In light of this, run with all of the might you can muster. Go the distance and be sure to pace yourself to make sure you have enough energy to get to the finish line so you can finally grab hold of and master what you have been pursuing. Wow. But you know what? Sometimes when you're running your race well, you are attacked. Something assails you from the side that tries to knock you out of the race. What triggers an attack? What triggers an attack? When you're running well, you're concentrated, you're giving it your very best effort, and suddenly an attack occurs that tries to knock you out of the race. What triggers a demonic attack? Well, I'll just tell you, the devil is terrified of you, and the devil doesn't want you to make it to the end. And I'm going to quote from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 11 and 12, where Paul says, "Whereunto I am appointed a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles." Then listen to what he says in verse 12, "For the which cause I also suffer these things." Now listen to the whole thing together. "Whereunto, unto this gospel," Paul says, "I am appointed." Here's what he says, "I'm called to be a preacher. I'm called to be an apostle. I'm called to be a teacher of the Gentiles." That's powerful. And a preacher, an apostle, a teacher. And then he adds, "For the which cause I also suffer these things," which means the devil was so threatened by the call on his life that Satan came to assault him. He did not want Paul to fulfill his call. His call triggered a demonic attack. And don't be surprised if when you're in progress to your finish line, something happens that tries to knock you out of the race. Just ignore it and keep pressing onward. And remember what the Apostle Paul said. He said, "Even me, I'm appointed a preacher. I'm appointed to be an apostle, a teacher, a mighty call on my life. And for the which cause, because of this call on my life, I've experienced a lot of crazy things that have come to throw me off." Wow. I say that Paul was really saying it like this. If you want to know why I've suffered so many crazy things during the course of my ministry, it's because I'm appointed a preacher, an apostle, and a teacher of the Gentiles. Satan was terrified of Paul finishing his assignment, which leads me now to 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 7, a very powerful verse which religious people misconstrue. Let's look at it. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. Paul says, unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. People read that and they say, oh, well, Paul was tempted to be conceited, so God gave him a thorn in the flesh. That is not what Paul says. Paul says, unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations. Paul was making breakthroughs that no one had ever made. He was preaching to people no one had ever preached to. He was reaching into brand new territories. And Paul says, lest I should really break into the very highest realms. Satan was so terrified of what I'm doing that he assigned me a messenger to buffet me. Now, the King James Version says, there was given me. So people say, well, God gave it to him. It doesn't say that. In fact, the verse plainly says it was the messenger of Satan. The word Satan, the Greek word Satanas, the word Satanas describes one who hates, accuses, slanders, or conspires against. Paul is literally saying the devil has created conspiracies to try to stop me from advancing into new realms. And then even said it was a messenger of Satan to buffet him. Wow, that word buffet is the Greek word kalaphizo, which means to strike with a fist. It pictures a person who is violently beaten, a beating by knuckles or fists, fists used as weapons of abuse. The Apostle Paul is literally saying, because of the abundance of revelations that I have received, because I'm breaking into new territory, going where no man has ever gone, and Satan is terrified of that, Satan assigned a messenger to me, a messenger of Satanas, Satan, that has conspired against me to take me down, trying to stop me because of the abundance of revelations. My friend, when you've got a great call on your life, don't be surprised if you experience some strange things along the way because the devil is terrified of you. But you need to make a decision. I don't care what the devil does or what life does. God has told me what I'm supposed to do, and I'm going to run this race until I finish. And the good news is God's power will empower you to press through every attack. God has called you to be a constant overcomer, and that's what I'm going to talk to you about in the next program. I'll be back in just a moment, and I'm going to pray for you.
Have you found the life you were born to live? You can fulfill God's destiny for your life with It's Time to Finish Your Assignment. In Rick Renner's five-part series, It's Time to Finish Your Assignment, you'll discover your God-given purpose and destiny. You'll learn that significance in life only comes when you know and live God's purpose for you. Available in physical or digital format starting at just $10, It's Time to Finish Your Assignment will inspire and challenge you to live the life you were created for. When you call or go online today, you'll also receive Rick's book, Dream Thieves, for free today only. Everyone has a dream for their life. But oftentimes we allow people or challenges to discourage us from pursuing that dream. You'll not only learn how to identify your own God-given dream, but how to walk to fulfill it for the glory of God. Call or go online now to get the sermon series, It's Time to Finish Your Assignment, starting at $10, and or the companion book, Dream Thieves, for free today only. 1-800-742-5593 or go to renner.org.
Hey, this is Rick Renner. This is where I sit every morning, where I meet with the Lord and I pray for our TV family, our partners, people that I love all over the world. And this is where I prepare my TV programs. And I have to tell you that preparing the program is the biggest part. Filming the program is the easy part. It takes hours and hours and hours to make sure I've put everything together correctly for you. And then from here, it goes to the TV suite where I sit down with my producer. And then he and I go over all the introductions that I have filmed in. So good to do these programs for the people who watch us all over the world. This is our studio. This really is where I live my life. And in this room, we prepare programs that ultimately go to multiple languages all over the face of the earth. They're primarily Russian and English. Wow, what a blessing. You know, the Bible tells us in Proverbs 10, verse 21, that the lips of the righteous feed many. It's my prayer that our teaching is feeding and nourishing many people. But when we're finished with my part, then the programs go into the edit suite, and that's what takes place in this room. And in this room, you can see there's people doing all kinds of things. They take the Greek words that I prepare. By the way, it takes a long time to prepare all those Greek words, but then they have to put them on the screen. They have to adjust the sound, adjust the color, They edit the whole program together with the music, the advertisements, the prayer, everything. And we create a teaching program for you. And our goal is to bring teaching that you can trust. That's our goal. That's my prayer. And I want to say thank you to you for helping all of us do it. It's not just me and Denise. There's a whole team here together. We're all committed to bringing good teaching to people. And your part's very important. So thank you for being a partner. Thank you for praying for us. And thank you for giving. Thank you for being with me today. What a pleasure that you and I can sit down together to open our Bibles. And right now we're looking at what we need to do to finish our assignment. You can finish what God has asked you to do. Don't say it's too hard, it's too difficult, it's taking too long. Just push through all of that. Don't say, well, the devil's knocking me out of the race, because you can push him out of the race. You have the power of God operating in you. That's what we're going to see in the next program, where I'm going to show you God has called you to be a perpetual overcomer. A perpetual overcomer. That's who you are in Christ. Don't miss the next program. But right now I'm offering you my series called It's Time to Finish Your Assignment. My friend, it's time. It's time for you to quit talking about it. It's time for you to do what God has called you to do. And by the way, when you finally finish it, it'll be such a load off of your mind. You'll finally feel good about yourself because you will have done what you know you're supposed to do. Get this series. It will really encourage you. We're also offering you today only for free my book called Dream Thieves, Overcoming Obstacles to Fulfill Your Dreams. You can do anything that God has called you to do. You just need to know how to do it. You can do it. And today, this is my gift to you today only. But I want to pray for you. Father, I thank you in the name of Jesus that it's true that greater is the one that is in us than he that is in the world. Lord, the greater one lives in us. Help us, Lord, to appropriate the Spirit of God in our life. And Holy Spirit, release your divine energy in us that will drive us toward finishing what you have called us to do. We thank you for the power to do it. Help us to run until we obtain. In Jesus' powerful, powerful name I pray, amen. Wow, it's been so good to be with you today. I'm looking forward to tomorrow when I'm going to tell you and show you from Scripture you are a perpetual overcomer. But until then, remember Ecclesiastes 8:4, where the word of a king is, there's power. Thanks for being with me. I'll see you in the next program.
Rick Renner Ministries is proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ through every available media to the uttermost parts of the earth. Discover the many ways you can help us make a difference in lives around the world with the word of God. We invite you to partner with us in teaching, strengthening, and rescuing lives for the glory of God. Together, we can make a difference that will last throughout eternity.